Hello? 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 I think I am just settling down. It is a bit awkward being like this, being to talk with you through the sound. But I am here to talk with you about what happened to me 5 or 6 years ago when I became a human radio channel. And what resulted from all those years ago when I became a human radio channel was a catastrophe of individuality. I mean, I simply forgot who I was. And no sooner did I become like a human radio channel than did I realize what a commitment to anti-personhood I had made. And this is like a kind of secret, like a family recipe, that I will share with you today on this intimate space where you can hear me but not see me. But it is okay, because the microphone is an old friend of mine and he lets me get away with all kinds of follies and contradictions, so it's okay. And so I am speaking, and air molecule by air molecule, I am inscribing the digital code of my speech into the microphone and out into your speaker. Air molecule by air molecule, I am tapping on your eardrum, and your eardrum is tickling your brain, and you say, I am listening. And now I will take you from the beginning of the story to how I became like this. It started 5 years ago in my artist studio. And while I was looking in the mirror and feeling quite depressed and distraught, after a while, I saw a very strange thing in the mirror. I saw I was looking at a very familiar foreigner. You see, I saw a lineage, a history, a genealogy. I saw my mother in my face, and I saw her mother, and I saw all the mothers in my face, but not just this kind of genealogy. In the clothes I was wearing, from the furry Russian hat on my head to the white silken blazer, I was borrowing moments of history denoted by fashion, borrowing traditions, borrowing expressions of feelings from people long gone, long time ago, through the objects and the genetic code that survived them. And so, while I was looking in the mirror, I became obviously quite worried, because I was not looking at myself no more. I was looking at a cocktail of a person, a cocktail of mothers and traditions and fashions gone by. And when I opened my mouth to speak, it was no longer my voice no more that I could hear. My chattering tongue spoke on behalf of the girl on the bus I heard speaking on the phone that day, on behalf of the woman who sold me a grapefruit, on behalf of the enigmatic promises of Rita Hayworth in old American films. Since then, I became a human radio channel. So it became my art practice, a practice of prolonged empathy, to go out shopping for new personalities, to recall memories that are not my own, to tell stories that are as true as my listening can allow. All right, are we live? Okay, let's take it from the beginning, guys. So today you're going to learn about 11 things girls should avoid doing in Freshers Week. So students, it's that time of the year again before you'll all flee the nest straight into the confusing drunken madness of Freshers Week. Here's some advice from Telegraph Wonder Women. Don't make the same mistakes we did. Forgotten about a certain sort of intimacy that can be found on the radio late at night. If you tune into the radio these days, you'll find something quite unnerving, and it is the shrill voice of some young early 30s presenter, which has, you know, been taught that the louder and more excitable the speech, the better for the radio. But that's not necessarily the case, and I very much miss the nighttime radio that we used to have in my day, where one could really tune into the radio and feel peace, feel this is a moment in the day where I can calm down, where I can let go of the day's toils and work and the tension in my bones and in my muscles, and I can retreat into this silence and just have the soothing company of a presenter that knows how to use their voice in that sort of nocturnal manner that is so well suited to the nighttime environment and acoustic. It must be understood, and most radio professional radio presenters that have been in the business for quite some time, most veterans of the industry will tell you that there are different kinds of acoustics at different times of the day, just as you can have different lights at different times of the day, like tungsten or incandescent light, you can have different acoustics. And so it is that in the evening, when the dusk is settling, there is a different kind of acoustic one must get used to. And so I find it particularly disappointing that this a crucial element of the cycles of acoustics throughout the day, regardless of where you find one finds oneself, is there in their living room or out taking a walk in the gardens or wherever, I feel it's an incredible pity that this has been omitted from the curriculum for young radio presenters today, and they seem completely oblivious to the fact that at different times of the day, you have different sensibilities to sound. The ears are simply pricking at different times in the day. They go through different cycles. Oral hormones are also, you know, going through their own motions. And so one has to take that into account when one is dealing with sound. At what point are the ears excitable during the day? And to work with these cycles almost in the manner of an ecosystem, a gardener who understands the seasons of the ears, of the day, of the acoustics of the day. And so I'm bitterly, bitterly disappointed, and have to say that even after a lifelong career in the radio arts, I have settled to boycott the radio because in its current state today, it is a great shame. It is a great embarrassment to its predecessors and to its ancestral heritage, though it's not a long heritage, to be sure, just a mere century or so, and yet so abominably disrespected by today's standards. And so I will not listen to the radio anymore.
ouvrez-moi bien vite. Coucou, mon cœur vous invite. Coucou, il faut nous aimer.
You're listening to the Human Radio Channel, and if you're just joining us now, we're focusing our programme today on ways in which what enters the ears sculpts the mouths through which we project our souls on a regular but rather spectacular basis. Now, we visited the sociological department of Bristol University to further interrogate this matter and found along the way that one of the major shapers of our individual identity and social makeup is our propensity to overlook, take for granted, and accept. We spoke with the Faculty of Human Neglect, and this is what their director had to say.
I'm a professor of sociology at the University of Bristol. And I'm here to talk to you about something very niche, which me and my department are studying at the moment. And it's really quite an interesting topic, one that's not commonly broached in sociology, the study of human interaction on a societal scale, human psychology and human relationships and behaviour. What I specialise in, what I'm studying at the university, is various forms of human neglect that we see today in Western societies. And so I often think about comparatively with the difficulty of studying forgetfulness. That's a very difficult problem to pinpoint, a blind spot, if you will, in being a psychologist of forgetfulness, because you try to pinpoint the very part that you can't see because you've already forgotten your research. And in a very similar manner, my colleagues and I sometimes find that the very thing we want to study, that we could, you know, if we had a third eye, look upon ourselves and observe upon ourselves, is our own neglect. But of course, by the very nature of neglect, we are not able to see that. So it's a very difficult area of study, and that is why it's become so niche. And very often we have to use ploys and devices such as mirrors to reflect our own neglect. When I talk about this subject, I want to broach it from a political angle as much as a psychogeographical angle, as much as an ecological angle, to think about human neglect towards the city, towards other humans, towards themselves, as we can often find is the case. But just to give an example, a very important kind of neglect is one human individual towards another human individual, or a group of human individuals towards another group. And we see all sorts of dynamics at play here. But one form of human neglect that is often neglected, again, as is the nature in this form of research, is that we neglect our elderly. So one of the ways in which we neglect our elderly, for there are many, you know, from structural to cultural, one of the ways is we forget to turn them to face another way from time to time. And then what happens is that they entirely bend one way or another. And it's for this very reason that our elderly are more radical than our youth. And thankfully, they only haven't the physical strength to act upon their extreme views. But put it this way, as analogies from nature always tend to clear up confusing concepts, let's use a tree. A tree on a mountainside eagerly leans to one side, tempting gravity, thanks to centuries of being beaten by predominantly westward winds. So this tree is forced in a sideway slant. A tree, sadly, cannot be turned periodically to amend this askewment. But thankfully, elderly people are a lot more like potted plants They're inclined toward the sunlit window. So in that way, we can keep turning the pot. And so our faculty examines these forms of neglect and then comes up with periodical reports, usually annual, in which we outline a series of recommendations about how we can combat these forms of human neglect. And we would recommend, in this case, that you visit your elderly loved ones at regular intervals and turn them to promote healthy upward and outward growing attitudes, and in this way mitigating the bitter asymmetry of stubborn habits. Yes, so there are other forms of neglect which may be more known to you, more obvious. We neglect the environment. In many ways, the human race, I suppose, is like a revered planetary plastic surgeon that in the middle of an elaborate series of operations had an epiphany and just up and left in the middle of it, basically. And this is the kind of pattern we've seen with previous civilizations as well, as this is not the first time that humans are changing the face of the planet. Possibly the planet will sue us and finish its own plastic surgery. And who knows what the consequences of that might be. So we've teamed up with the International Panel on Climate Change to kind of collaborate on a new report. We're working on them to offer what we know about human neglect and about what can be done to mitigate the crisis from that angle. And another form of neglect is we neglect the greater and lesser altitudes of our field of vision. So this is not an obvious form of neglect at all, because a vision is one of our primary means of observation. And if we observe neglect with our eyes, how can we observe people neglecting their operation for observation? So we neglect these greater and lesser altitudes of our field of vision. Imagine that often you may, from now on, note people neglect to register what is going on from as little as 30 degrees off their implicit horizon, and that would be, you know, eye level. And this is because, alas, a lot of dangers present themselves around this focal area of sight. You've got cars, other people, signs and advertisements, all of which we must continually look out for. If this habit of looking, this narrowed form of observing, is not rectified within the next couple of centuries, our research institute predicts that if our outlook is not diversified by then, we may expect our species to become incrementally visually impaired in these areas and more vulnerable to attack from both above and below. So we see that there are some serious issues connected to human neglect. And a lot of these are political issues. And yet, on a personal stance, and I've been invited here to talk about my research from a personal stance, one of my main issues with politics is that I don't know much about it. An even bigger issue relating to that is that I don't care. So what is the question here? What ideological systems are in place here to promote my continued apathy? This could be the introduction to an investigative documentary. What systems are in place here to make me so apathetic? But alas, I shall never have the persuasion or sense of initiative to make such a documentary because I don't care. So forgetfulness, neglect and apathy are all cycles in which observation and science is structurally excluded. It's hard to access forgetfulness. It's hard to access neglect. And it's hard to access what you do not care about.
What block is this?
This is Stockwell. This is
M Block.
Merceau Estate.
Is it M Block?
Nah.
It's not.
I didn't remember.
Remember
them little kids that we saw before?
I swear that
was somewhere.
Yeah.
There were some little kids yesterday.
He was popping wheelies on that.
Hello, man. Is he stupid?
What?
Hey, man, I'm out of here. I'm out of here.
Out, out, out and about. The city is a sprawling network of busybodies and interlocking stories. Sometimes it's not clear whose story belongs to who. The narratives that build up our social and individual identities are such delicious collectibles that we seem quite happy to swap and share experiences with friends, TV shows, novels, cinema, radio interviews. You're listening to the Human Radio Channel, the only channel to declare its own agency with a tattling tongue. We entered the city last Friday in order to ask it about the nature of its inhabitants and their social habits. Stay tuned for more.
I'm really suspicious of the ways people talk sometimes. When they're stuck on the subway and they're sitting on their benches and ignoring each other, just staring into their devices. Sometimes I've been grocery shopping and I'm just waiting for the bus. And it's a warm summer's day and the children are out playing and you can see a chemistry between them. They know how to interact with the objects around them in such a healthy manner. And here I am standing, feeling isolated. Let go, let go, let go of what you're doing. Put down the groceries. Come toward me, get to know me. Why are you all so afraid? That was my thought when I was standing there that summer's day. Wondering why nobody would notice me. Not because I'm a narcissist, but because everybody requires attention. Some kind of meager form of love. It's the lowest form of love, this kind of attention. Just to be noticed, just to be regarded. Acknowledged as somebody walks past. Somebody who has a feeling that I exist and that's perfectly okay, although it does not impact their lives in any certain way, any significant way at all. That's all I want. A person without that can go absolutely crazy. Like a world without mirrors. People are mirrors. They reflect and imitate each other. And I don't know who I am if I don't know who you are, who anyone is. Everyone's turned away from me as if I'm Medusa. There is a kind of fear, a subliminal kind of comfortable fear in everybody's behavior, in their way of being, their manner. In their posture, they're like sitting ducks.
Sunrise, this is the last day that I'll ever see. Out in the courtyard, they're ready for me. But I go to my Lord with no fear, 'cause I did what I did for Maria.
I'm going into some kind of relapse. And it's dragging me down.
As I rode into town, with the sun going down, all the windows were barred, there was no one around. For they knew that I'd come, with my hand on my gun, and revenge in my heart for Maria. My dearest departed Maria. Take an eye for an eye, and a life for a life. And somebody must die for the death of my wife. Yes, I did what I did for Maria.
there's something funny in the air.
Laughter echoed across from the end of the street. There was the man I was burning to meet, and my mind was so calm and so clear as I took my revenge for Maria. And he fell to the ground, raising dust all around, but I knew he was dead long before he went down. It was quick, it was clean, made it easy on him, which is more than he did for Maria when he did what he did to Maria.
Look out of your window, ladies and gentlemen, and tell me, what do you see? We've got a big city in front of us. What do you think is going on out in that city outside your bedroom window? Let me tell you right now that at this time of the night, it's probably not pretty. It is crazy. Absolutely bonkers. But I can't bloody wait until the housing give me a 2-bedroom flat and house just somewhere I can call home for me and my child. But it's not born yet. But I'm just under 5 months now and my baby will be here, and I can't wait to start my family with my lovely husband. But I never thought life would feel and would be this so amazing. But I'm blessed and I'm extremely happy that we found each other and that we feel comfortable and that we're building this home together. Because I think we're ready for it. We've been in a long-term relationship, but I must be the only lass that's pregnant this young and don't even look it or feel it. But I'm blessed, and so is my man. I've been listening to some really good tunes to keep me happy, because they say that stress is not good when you're pregnant. So I've been taking and eating right. Stop eating chips and stop eating unhealthy things. And got a nice cup of tea beside me all the time that my mum makes for me. And we just get by. But it's all right, really. I don't complain much about my life situation. Oh my God, I get so tired when I'm pregnant. Every time.
That was Kelsey and her unborn child sharing prospects for a happy future. It has been a pleasure to have you with us, ladies and gentlemen, as we struggle to manage precarity, political uncertainty, and quizzical technological advancements. What does the future hold? You're listening to the Human Radio Channel, the channel that denotes the past and the future in one alert and urgent presence. Before we finish the programme, we'd like to take a final look at the themes discussed. Stay tuned for more.
How to call it? Mindfulness is a mental practice, as a practice of meditation, has become a very popular in pop culture, even like when you YouTube, I am depressed, the top result will be the recommendation for the mindfulness technique. And it happens to everybody that everybody feels depressed. Yesterday I was walking on the pavement and my legs were going faster than I could. And this is a particular mode of depression which I commonly fall into, which has to do with the things about myself, my simulacra. I can see them flying past ahead of me. I can see them in front of me and I'm trying to race up to them, but I cannot reach them. I'm already behind, still evaluating who am I, as an individual. And that takes time, of course. One can only do it in retrospective format. I look back at my childhood, I look back at what I did. I had dreams and I played with other children. And I remember particular memories of fishing for the prawns in the shallow water, or chasing a crab out of the pool, or setting fire to dried grass that has been chopped down. and all the children forming around it, and these very cinematic scenes pop into my head, and I position myself in that story, in that narrative, and I say, this is who I am. But this is a process that takes time. This is a retrospective process, a process that drags behind. Already my impressions are making their way through this world. I am scattering them like a glass jar of marbles that is spilling over, and my personality traits, they are spilling before me. And so to combat this depression that I am too slow for my own personal progression, I did a very simple trick, and I said, I am going to be in the chariot of my personality. So I shall connect myself with the reins, with the strings. I shall tie them into the bite of the horse, which is my simulacra. And I shall sit back in my chariot and watch my personality rage ahead. And I will sit in the back and say, hello, I am charging. I don't know where, I don't know who I am, but here I am. And you will know before even I will.